Hi, I'm Logan, and in today's video, we're going to be going over how to calculate the amounts that should be included in an individual's gross income as reported on Form 1040, which is an individual income tax return, including wages, interest and dividends, guaranteed payments received from a partnership, income from a qualified retirement plan, and punitive damages. There's a lot of stuff we're going to go over today. With that said, we're going to be learning how to do this the SuperfastCPA way, which is going straight into questions to learn the material. If you haven't really heard much about our strategies, or if this is the first video you're seeing from us, again, that is our strategy. We go straight into the questions. If you're interested in learning more about our strategies, and if you like this video, make sure you go to superfastcpa.com and watch our free one-hour webinar training. The link will be in the description, where we go over the six key ingredients to passing the CPA exam. Again, it's 1 hour, it's free, and it will save you months and months of struggling with your studying process. One more thing about this video. I will only be going over 5 questions in this video to learn this topic, but SuperfastCPA members will have access to the full video where I go over 10 questions. All right, with all that said, let's jump straight into some questions. All right, here's the first question. During the year, Jane Doe had several sources of income. She inherited $30,000 from her late aunt, which she placed in savings. Her full-time job paid her wages amounting to $45,000. From a state lottery, Jane won $10,000 after purchasing a ticket for $500. Additionally, under a divorce agreement executed in 2017, Jane receives an annual alimony of $15,000 from her ex-husband, along with child support payments totaling $6,000. What amount should Jane report as her gross income on her tax return? All right, so if you don't know much about individual income taxes, you might not know what goes into an individual's gross income, except for maybe, you know, the wages. That's probably pretty straightforward. But if you don't know much about it, that's okay, because we're going to be going straight into the answers here pretty soon and learning more about this. If you need a second, pause the video, make sure you understand what it's asking, read through it again, and when you're ready, come back and we will look at the answer. All right, here's the answer. $70,000. So what goes into it? Jane's gross income for the year should include her wages, of course, alimony, and lottery winnings. According to the tax laws, inheritance and child support are not considered taxable income. Okay, that's a really good thing to learn right there. Inheritance and child support are not taxable. Therefore, Jane's gross income is comprised of her wages from employment, alimony received based on the pre-2019 divorce agreement, and you might be like, why does it matter the year? Well, we're about to learn about that. And state lottery winnings of $10,000, totaling $70,000. So let's learn a little bit more about a few of the things here. Alimony payments are amounts paid to a spouse or former spouse under a divorce or separation instrument, in case you didn't know much about alimony. The tax treatment of such payments has changed due to the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act of 2017. For divorce or separation agreements executed on or after January 1st, 2019, alimony payments are no longer deductible by the payer, nor are they includable in the income of the recipient. However, for agreements executed before this date, the old rules apply, meaning alimony payments remain deductible for the payer and are considered taxable income for the recipient. So that's what, there's a big distinction there for alimony payments. If it's alimony for a divorce that was filed starting in at the beginning of 2019 or later, then the alimony is not deductible for the person paying it and not taxable for the person receiving it. But if it was before 2019, then it's the reverse. It is deductible for the person paying it, and it is taxable for the person receiving it. So alimony isn't necessarily listed specifically in the topic that we're going over today, but it is something that most likely could come up in the exam. So that's why we're still going over it. As for the treatment of lottery winnings slash gambling, these are included in gross income. The amount paid for the winning ticket does not reduce the taxable income. However, for gambling losses slash costs of tickets that did not win, these can be counted as an itemized deduction up to the amount of gambling winnings. So in this case, we aren't really talking about itemized deductions. We're only talking about the winnings. We're not talking about the losses. And then the non-taxable items, the inheritance and the child support, obviously aren't included in the gross income. So there's a lot of things that we learned there about what goes into gross income. Of course, wages, lottery goes into it, and you don't get to deduct the ticket, or as in you don't get to reduce your gross income by the amount that you paid for the ticket. Since this divorce was before 2019, then the alimony is taxable, and then child support is never taxable. And that's something that did not change from the TCJA. So that was the same either way. All right, let's go to the next question. All right, here's the next question. Throughout the tax year, Robert Lane experienced several financial events. He was employed part-time and earned wages totaling $24,000. In addition, he received $600 as interest income from municipal bonds. And just letting you know, municipal is something kind of like in a city or in a, you know, kind of in a locality, not necessarily a state per se. He was also awarded unemployment compensation of $2,000 during a brief period of joblessness. Furthermore, a partnership in which he is a non-active partner made a guaranteed payment to him for his invested capital amounting to $18,000. What is the total amount that Robert must include in his gross income for the current tax year? All right, take a second, pause the video, read through it. These are some new things that could or could not be included in gross income. So think about it, and when you're ready, come back and we'll go over the answer. All right, let's go ahead and look at the answer. All right, $44,000. Robert must include his wages, of course, and the guaranteed payment from the partnership in his gross income. Just a little about guaranteed payments from partnerships. It's kind of like a salary from the partnership for, like, as in they will get this money no matter how well the partnership does or how much money the partnership makes. So it's separate from the total income of the business. It is just money that they will receive for being a partner in the partnership. The interest income from municipal bonds is typically exempt from federal income tax and thus not included in gross income. So even though it's interest income, since it's from municipal bonds, it is not going to be taxable. Unemployment compensation is also taxable and must be included in gross income. Therefore, the total gross income reported should be the sum of his wages, the unemployment compensation, and the guaranteed payment. The municipal bond interest is not included. So that totals to $44,000. All right, we learned a few more things. Again, unemployment, taxable, guaranteed payments, taxable, interest income, maybe taxable, but if it's from a municipal bond, not taxable. All right, let's go to the next question. All right, here's the next question. Martin Smith, who is 65 years old, has decided to begin taking distributions from his retirement accounts. This year, he took out $50,000 from his 401k plan, to which he had made contributions on a pre-tax basis. So this means that his contributions were just taken straight out of his paycheck before they were even taxed and put into his 401k plan. Additionally, he began receiving payments from a fixed period annuity into which he had invested $145,000 and which is designed to pay out $12,000 annually for the next 15 years. What amount from these distributions should be included in Martin's gross income for the current tax year? All right, read through this, make sure you understand what's going on, and when you're ready, come back and we'll look at the answer to learn more about what goes into gross income. All right, here's the answer. Martin's entire 401k distribution is taxable and must be included in his gross income since the contributions were made on a pre-tax basis. So again, like I said, it was put into that 401k before it had even been taxed, so he has to pay taxes on it now. For the annuity, part of each payment is a return of the initial investment, which is not taxable, and the remainder is the taxable income. The non-taxable portion is calculated by dividing the total investment by the number of payments, so $145,000 divided by 15 years. So that means $9,667 per year is just a return of capital, basically them just giving him back the money that he put in. The taxable portion of the annuity payment is the annual payment minus the return of capital, which is $12,000 minus $9,667, and that equals $2,333. So we add up the 401k distribution of $50,000 and the taxable portion of the annuity, which is $2,333, and that gives us the $52,333. Pretty simple there. You basically just, for the annuity at least, since it's a fixed period one, you just take what was put in, divide it by the 15 years, and then whatever that is, that portion of the annual payment is not taxable because it's just a return of capital. All right, let's go to the next question. All right, here's the next question. John, a self-employed consultant, encountered a few unusual transactions this year. In a legal settlement, John received $50,000 for punitive damages related to a breach of contract case. Additionally, he engaged in a barter transaction where he provided consulting services valued at $1,200 to an architect, who, in exchange, rendered architectural services valued at $1,500 for a renovation John had planned for his home office. Based on these events, what amount should John report as income for the current tax year? So just based off of these events, we don't know if he made money from anything else. So $50,000 from the punitive damages, is that taxable? And then what amount of this is going to be counted as income, if any, from the barter? So take a second, think about it. When you're ready, let's come back and look at the answer. All right, here's the answer. So looks like the $50,000 of punitive damages is taxable, and then the value of the renovation is taxable. So let's read this. According to tax law, punitive damages are generally included in gross income, even if they relate to a personal injury. So John must include the full $50,000 of punitive damages as income. When services are traded, the fair market value of the services received is included in income. Therefore, John must also include the $1,500 value of the architectural services he received, even though the services he provided were of lesser value. So even though his was only worth $1,200, whatever he received, that's what's taxable income to him. Thus, the total income John should report for the current tax year is the sum of the punitive damages and the fair market value of the architectural services, which equals $51,500. All right. Most of the stuff you're seeing here is pretty straightforward. You just need to know what the rules are, because before this, you might not have known that punitive damages are typically taxable. You might not have known that it's the fair market value of a barter transaction that's taxable. So once you know these things, they're pretty straightforward. All right, let's go to the next question. All right, here's the next question. Susan Miller, a retired teacher, had various sources of income during the year. She received $6,000 in interest from corporate bonds and $4,000 in dividends from her stock investments. Susan also began taking distributions from her Roth IRA, from which she withdrew $10,000. During the year, she received Social Security benefits amounting to $18,000. Her other income totals put her in a situation where 85% of her Social Security benefits are taxable. Considering these figures, how much should Susan report as her gross income for the current tax year? All right, so this interest is not from a municipal bond, so is it going to be taxable? Are these dividends going to be taxable? We're five questions in, but this is new stuff. See if you can think about it and figure out what is taxable, what's not taxable, or use your knowledge that you currently have. And when you're ready, come back and we'll look at the answer. All right, $25,300. Susan's gross income includes interest from corporate bonds and dividends, so that makes sense. Normal interest and normal bond and normal dividends are taxable, whereas, as we remember from before, the interest from the municipal bonds was not taxable. Her Roth IRA distributions are generally not taxable if certain conditions are met, such as the account being at least 5 years old and the distributions are taken after reaching age 59 and a half. Assuming Susan meets these conditions, the Roth IRA distribution is not included in her gross income. So just a note on Roth IRAs. So, you know, a 401k or a normal IRA, those are pre-tax dollars. So the money that you put in has not been taxed yet. And so that money is taxed when it's taken out. The awesome thing about Roth IRAs is that you take money that has already been taxed. So it's the money that you actually got in your paycheck. You decide to put it in your Roth IRA, but since it's already been taxed, when you take it out, you know, 40 years later or whatever, it's not taxable, which is awesome because taxes are always going to go up. So that's how it works with Roth IRAs. Assuming Susan meets these conditions, not including the gross income, we read that already. However, 85% of her Social Security benefits are considered taxable based on her income level. Therefore, Susan should include 85% of $18,000, which is $15,300, in addition to the $6,000 in bond interest and $4,000 in dividends, totaling $25,300 as her gross income. So we're not going to dive super deep into Social Security benefits in this video, but basically there are different things that can affect how much of your Social Security benefits are taxable. In this situation, though, we're just assuming that the 85% is taxable. So that means that that $15,300 is taxed. So the total ends up being the $10,000 plus the $15,300. So $25,300 is taxable. So we learned a lot there as well. Biggest thing to pay attention to is the Roth IRA, I would say. And then again, we're not going to dive super deep into Social Security benefits in this video. All right, we went over a lot of things so far. Before we go any further, let's do another part of the process, which is called pillar topics. Now, if you don't know much about the strategy of SuperfastCPA, again, we do the questions to learn the material mainly. And another great part of it is called pillar topics. This is where you take what you've learned over the past questions, you know, in this case, the past five questions, and you try to summarize, try to pick out what were obviously the most important things that you were supposed to know and learn for the exam based off of these questions. So let's go ahead and go into making the pillar topics. Okay, first pillar topic, let's just start listing what things go into gross income. What goes into gross income to be taxed? Wages, obviously. interest from bonds, except for municipal bonds. Let's just keep going. Dividends from investments, distributions from normal IRAs or 401ks, some social security benefits. Let's see. Alimony received from a divorce before 2019. What is not included? Roth IRA distributions. Oh, we forgot to include punitive damages. That is another thing. IRA distributions, child support, alimony received for divorce. Oops. Let's fix that. I don't want it to go off the screen. After 2019, inheritance, annuities. Well, parts of annuities. We might not write that out super in detail right this second. And then barters do include FMV or fair market value of service received. All right. So pretty straightforward once you know what goes into it and what doesn't go into it, but it might be hard to remember all those things. So that's why you make the pillar topics. And you could even like try to make a mnemonic for yourself. You could do whatever you need to do to remember these things. But these are the pillar topics. These are all the things that go into it: wages, interest from bonds, except for municipal bonds, dividends from investments, distributions from normal IRAs or 401ks. Like these are things that are taxable. Some social security benefits, alimony before 2019, punitive damages, what's not included, Roth IRA distributions, child support, alimony after 2019, inheritance, parts of annuities. And then another thing was that barters, whatever what the fair market value of the thing was that you received, that is also included in your gross income. All right, we learned a lot in this video. Just as a reminder, this is the end of this video. We only went over 5 questions, but SuperfastCPA members will have access to the full video where I go over another 5 questions for a total of 10 questions. If you liked this video, make sure to like it, leave a comment, and share this video with anybody you know who is going through the CPA exams. Especially make sure you go to superfastcpa.com and watch our free 1-hour webinar training. Again, the link is in the description, where we go over the 6 key ingredients to passing the CPA exam. It will save you so much time of struggling and failing these exams. Please go watch it. Again, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.